name's Dean Whyatt. I'm a broadcast journalist. I've been a broadcast journalist for 40 years and more, with my roots in English local radio. And now it's my very great privilege and pleasure to lead the European Centre for Press and Media Freedom, an organisation that you may not yet have heard of because we are brand new. We're based in Leipzig in East Germany, and we aim to bring together, along the theme that we've just heard, bring together like-minded people who are campaigning for quality journalism, for independent investigative journalism, and for press and media freedom everywhere that it may be threatened. So, let's do this. Of course, there are threats at the moment to public service media all over Europe. There are threats from governments who choose to see their public broadcasters sometimes as their own playthings for political means. There are threats from private media who don't understand why a license fee or some other public levy should give a public service broadcaster a commercial advantage that they cannot challenge. There are threats too from the switch to digital, of course, in the age of box sets and, oh, sorry. Yes, in the age of box sets, who is going to listen to the local radio news? Well, actually, I happen to feel, and I know this is true in my own country, the United Kingdom, and also in Leipzig, East Germany, where I live, that new hyper-local news sites are popping up, and even small local communities. There's one just starting near me called nebenan.de, where my neighbours are getting in touch with me to say, do you know what's happening about the new parking system and stuff like that? So actually, there is still a need for local and regional news that people can trust. And even in the global age, we are still requiring those sort of trusted things which quality journalism gives. There's also, of course, no big national audience now, except for a special occasion such as a coronation, a royal wedding. We still have these things in the United Kingdom. Football, of course, brings people together, huge musical events and cultural events. But generally speaking, the people we used to think of as the audience are fragmented, and they're using all sorts of different devices and platforms to access our journalism. Cost cutting always hits local and regional journalism first, in my experience. I'm sure it's no different in the rest of Europe from in the United Kingdom. So, we as the European Centre for Press and Media Freedom are taking these developments very seriously. We've identified some particular problems in Poland, Great Britain, Greece, Hungary, Spain. We're going to Croatia next month on a fact-finding mission. And in January, we led a fact-finding mission to Poland with the International Press Institute based in Vienna and the European Federation of Journalists based in Brussels. And this was a strange fact-finding mission from my point of view, because we went to Poland and we interviewed more than 30 representatives of broadcasters, trade unions, civil society representatives, and we found that there were very few facts. And of course, a fact-finding mission with no facts is in some senses, a failure. But from my point of view, it's a great success because it showed to me how very complicated the situation is in Poland and probably everywhere else as well. So I've decided to group the findings from our Poland fact-finding mission into positives and negatives. And although we went to the end of January, this mission continues. My latest interview for the mission actually took place last Wednesday with the head of TVP Historia, who was making a presentation in Leipzig at the MDR Medientreff. He's very much in favor of all the new developments, as you might expect. He runs a history channel, which is mostly focused on Polish national culture and those aspects of Polish history which are worth celebrating and bringing to a new generation. And he told me, in fact, that his history channel is very popular with young people, and they all go around wearing TVP Historia t-shirts. That's what he said. So among the positives he identified from the new media law in Poland are that funding will be secured by a levy on electricity bills, using what I think is quite a novel mechanism, where they count the number of electrical sockets you have in your home or your business, and the license fee is calculated according to that. Obviously, this will bring an element of financial stability into Polish public service broadcasting that it has been lacking ever since the then Prime Minister Donald Tusk said that he never paid his license fee and he didn't know anybody who did. Well, with that kind of support from your top politicians, of course, public service broadcasting is going to suffer financially. So financial security may be one of the positives of the new regime in Polish national and public service broadcasting. Also identified by two out of the three journalist unions that we talked to, is that the new contracts for people who still have a job in TV Poland and Radio Polska are more likely to be staff contracts than freelance or contracted out or independent production contracts. So they have greater security in that sense, in a financial sense. And according to the supporters of the Law and Justice Party's changes in the Polish TV landscape, the new changes address injustices committed by the previous liberal governments, and they are more honest in the way that they're portrayed. Of course, the negatives are well known to everybody. Now the Treasury Minister is directly in charge of appointing senior staff at the Polish public broadcaster. There were mass sackings when the new government took over and people continued to lose their jobs because of political affiliations rather than because of any defects in the quality of their journalism. And the new governing body will be a national cultural council with emphasis on those words national and culture rather than a more general body with a 7-year term of office appointed from across a range of civil society and political sources. So that's Poland. Now we also have the white paper on the future of the BBC, which follows directly from the report by David Clementi into the BBC's future. Now, as I mentioned at the start, I've been a broadcast journalist in the UK for very many years, and so I can remember the Peacock Commission, which set out to privatise the BBC, and the famous quote from the then Director General that privatisation would be a bad thing, and you can't have a little bit of it, in the same way that you can't be a little bit pregnant. That was Alistair Milne, the then BBC Director General. So this is an argument that has gone on across the years. There are some positives in the new white paper. You can see the license fee will rise with inflation. Greater diversity is promised for ethnic minorities. That doesn't mean just the BME visible ethnic minorities, but of course also the minority languages such as Welsh, Gaelic, Roma, Polish, and so on. There will be more funds for the nations and regions of the BBC as a proportion of the total, not, I don't think as an absolute, but as a proportion. And the future of the World Service is assured in the White Paper. And of course, the World Service is a national and international treasure of the BBC. So all that is very much to be applauded. On the downside, and this might begin to remind you a little bit of what's going on in Poland and elsewhere, half of the new body that will replace the BBC Trust will be directly appointed by the government. Half, including the chair and the vice chair. The process of getting a little bit more pregnant continues, because from the end of 2016, commercial broadcasters will be able to bid for the big, lucrative BBC entertainment slots, so beyond the existing quotas allowed for independent production. And Ofcom, which is the body that oversees standards across the whole of private media, will also take over from the BBC in terms of upholding standards, that means editorial standards, taste and decency, and political impartiality, and dealing with complaints about any alleged infringements there. So from my point of view, all of these new developments signaled in the White Paper are negatives because they begin to erode the independence of the BBC, its clear voice, and it's maybe a slow, maybe a creeping sort of change, but it seems to me to be an attack. Why it matters, well, I'm sure I don't need to say this to any of you, but public service is not state broadcasting. It's not a government mouthpiece. It's not the shrine of national cultural identities. Media freedom means plurality, and viewers and listeners need a genuine choice, and they need public service media that they can trust to be truly independent, investigative, properly funded, and able to withstand political pressure. Now, can anyone tell me what this picture shows? Have a guess. It's in England. It's 90 years ago. Do you need more clues? It was the general strike of 1926. And the BBC, in its very infancy, led by a very young first Director General, John Rees, came under huge sustained pressure from the government, in particular the Chancellor Winston Churchill. You might have heard of him. Winston Churchill wanted to commandeer the BBC, which at the time was the British Broadcasting Company, so that he could broadcast directly to the strikers, tell them to get back to work, stop holding the country to ransom, and so on and so on and so on. And John Reid very bravely stood up to all that pressure and persuaded the Prime Minister, Stanley Baldwin, not to give in, but to continue to defend the BBC as an independent, impartial force. That was 90 years ago. But that attitude is still needed today, even in a multi-channel, multi-platform sort of world. We still need to hang on to that idea that public service broadcasting matters because it is different. And we need to stand up for the difference. That's for me on Poland and the UK, just to prove that we're not picking on Poland. There are problems elsewhere, including in my home country, where public service broadcasting, of course, was invented. And also, as I've just mentioned, very severely tested, even from the earliest days. Now I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Vesselin Dimitrov, who will tell you a little bit more about this thing called the European Centre for Press and Media Freedom, what we're all about and why we're here.
So much, and thanks for inviting us, actually. While we try to upload this other PowerPoint, two things from my side. First of all, we cannot be more different. I mean, I work for print, and I work for private media, but I really admire you guys, and and the job that, that the public broadcasting is serving to our societies is really huge. So I really admire what you're doing. And the second thing is, I'm local, I'm Bulgarian, I serve on the supervisory board of the ECPMF. And I'm so happy that you're here, because Plovdiv is, you might have seen a bit from it, but Plovdiv is a very a vibrant city, a very vital city. It's very hip. Nowadays, we people from Sofia tend to come here to party. So if you, if you're asking yourself where to go, I'll give you a hint. It's a place called The Trap or Kapana. But maybe you should contact me later to tell you exactly where this is. The ECPMF is not a trap. The ECPMF is the European Center for Press and Media Freedom. I'll give you a very quick introduction to what we're doing. There are a lot of organizations that are committed to fight or to add, to make advocacy on press freedom on our continent. But the idea of the ECPMF is to put them, or at least put a huge, a vast amount of them together. We are a consortium of six partners. We were founded a year ago. We're based in Leipzig. Those, if there is anyone in, from Germany here, you, you might know that, that the people in Leipzig consider themselves, consider their city the city of freedom, because that, that's where in 1989 the peaceful revolution started. And last October, we presented ourselves to the public on the media press freedom and press freedom conference. You should save the day, because this year on the 6th and 7th of October, we'll be again in Leipzig, and you're all invited to join us. We are actually quite a unique structure. We are the first non-for-profit European cooperative. The distinguished thing about this European cooperative system is, or this legal thing, is that once it's founded in one state of the European Union, it could be active within all other member states. So that's unique. The structure is also unique because we are owned by the members. You could buy shares. The membership is 100 euros, and so you get a share. It's like a normal company. With buying this share, you become a member, you have a vote, and you share the responsibility of the ECPMF. So, I want to use this opportunity that we're here and we get it to invite you all to become members of the ECPMF. We currently have 35 members from 18 countries. As I said, the ECPMF is a consortium. The leading partner is based in Germany, is the Media Foundation of the Sparkasse Leipzig. But then we also have people working on the field in Italy, people observing the press freedom on the Balkans, Sociogeno, Conservatorio Balcani. We also have the Journalism Fund from Belgium on, as one of our partners. We have people who deal with press and media law, and the Austrian Southeastern Europe Media Organization is also within our partners. You can see who sponsors us so far, but let's go to what we are actually doing. We are monitoring, we are doing advocacy for press freedom, we are reporting on press freedom violations. We have a journalist in residence program where we invite a journalist from Europe who's in danger to come to Leipzig and stay there for 6 or 12 months and work in a protective environment. We are digital as well. We have a very nice website. We are all over the social media, and on our website and via our social media channels, you could hear, read, and view current violations on press freedom. You can also subscribe to our newsletter called The Update, where you can get everything new on the matters of press freedom. We have a great resource center, which is a place that I highly recommend you to visit. It is a structured set of publications and data, not only on press freedom actually, but also on media in general, all the news publications, scientific reports, and everything else is uploaded there. It's an open platform, so you can upload your materials as well. It's a very easy access, and it's a great network tool for the whole community of press on the continent. Jane already told you about our fact-finding missions. There's three of them are still going on. Another one in Croatia is about to start next month. But in general, if I have to summarize, the ECPMF is about gaining freedom for media, from freedom from violence, freedom from surveillance, freedom from imprisonment, freedom from propaganda, freedom from political violence. Here you can see Jane in front of Pegida demonstrants, I think, in Germany, and freedom from police action. And let's end up with something positive. We have a writing competition going on. Unfortunately, it's only up to, you can apply there if you're up to 25 years of age, and it's not 27, sorry, but you might have kids that you could urge to apply there. So thank you very much, and we're looking forward to hearing questions and comments from you, maybe in the pauses. Thanks so much.